Hi everyone, let's talk about posterior fossa cystic malformation. Some of the lesions that you have come across during your rotation or when you study for board exam, and I suspect some of the entities is a little bit confusing to some of you. Let's start with four different patients. All four of them seemingly has posterior fossa cystic malformation. Hopefully patient A looks quite different than rest of the lesion, and for those of you who are studying for board exam, you probably can recognize quickly based on the classic feature of this particular entity. So before we get there, let's look at some of the important landmarks that we need to recognize that we can use them to tell different lesions apart. The projection that you want to use is going to be from the mid-sagittal view. If you look at the floor of the fourth ventricle or the posterior aspect of the brainstem, it should be a flat line. Halfway of the pons, the line that perpendicular to the floor of the fourth ventricle, just right inferior to that, that's fastigium, the apex of the roof of the fourth ventricle. Its orientation is pointed directly 90 degrees perpendicular to the floor of the fourth ventricle. So that orientation is quite important. Vermis comprise of different lobules. For the purpose of our inspection, we don't really need to know the exact name of different lobules. But what you should be able to recognize are those two prominent fissures, primary fissure, preparamental fissure, just posterior to the pyramid. Using these two fissures, you can divide the vermis roughly into three sections. The three sections, as you've seen, should be roughly equal in size. In particular, the second section is probably the smallest. If you see the inferior section is much smaller than the second section, then you're looking at inferior vermian hypoplasia. Another thing of note is foramina magendis, also known as the median aperture. Together with foramina luccica, they serve as an outlet for CSF to extend from ventricular system out into subarachnoid space. During the formation of subarachnoid space, you have an evagination of the pouch called Blake's pouch. Roughly around 12th gestational week, the Blake's pouch will start to fenestrate, then eventually involute, forming foramina magendi. So if something goes wrong with this process, that can lead to certain type of cystic malformation, as we'll see. So let's look at patient A. Here you see a marked expansion of the cystic space inferior to the vermis. You can see the vermis is globally hypoplastic. This is a classic picture of Dendy-Walker malformation. This large expansion Dendy-Walker cyst is not arachnoid cyst, and it does not communicate with subarachnoid space. Therefore, it's very common for a Dendy-Walker malformation patient to present with hydrocephalus, to present with obstruction. You see a vermian hypoplasia. Here you can see the third lobe is significantly smaller than the first two. In fact, the entire vermis is globally hypoplastic. You can see there's abnormal upturn of the fastigium, and the fourth ventricle is markedly expanded and is not covered by the vermis. That's a classic picture for Dendy-Walker malformation. Because of the expansion of the Dendy-Walker cyst, usually you will see enlargement of the posterior fossa, elevation of the torcula and the tentorium. Remember, tentorium should be oriented approximately 45 degrees this direction, and in this case, it's markedly elevated. Dendy-Walker is often associated with many other congenital anomalies, such as corpus callosum degenesis or other migrational anomaly. What about this one for comparison? Here, the patient seems to have a partial feature of Dendy-Walker malformation. There's expansion of the cystic space inferior to the vermis. You can see the inferior vermis is hypoplastic. However, the posterior fossa is not expanded. There is enlargement of the first ventricle. Another thing that you can do is also measure the so-called tegmental vermian angle. You draw a line parallel to the floor of the fourth ventricle, and second line parallel to the anterior aspect of the vermis. Normally, the TV angle should be less than 18 degrees. In fact, usually these two lines are parallel to each other. You should be roughly 0 degree. In this case, it's abnormally expanded. Whenever you see abnormal expansion of the TV angle, the fastigium is usually abnormally upturned, like in this case. Because of the partial feature of Dendy-Walker malformation, this used to call various different names such as Dendy-Walker variant, Dendy-Walker complex, or Dendy-Walker spectrum. This is something that we try to discourage because it caused a lot of confusion. Instead, we can be specific in this description. In this case, you have an inferior vermian hypoplasia. What about this case right here? So let's look at some of the important landmarks. Look like the vermis is normal in size. There's mild mass effect against the inferior part of the vermis, but it is not hypoplastic. What about fourth ventricle? The fourth ventricle is enlarged, but the tegmental vermian angle, those two lines are parallel and it's roughly 0 degree, so that's normal. The posterior fossa is not expanded. The patient does have hydrocephalus, so there's an obstruction. What is this entity? This is Blake's pouch cyst. Recall Blake's pouch should involute at 12th gestational week, forming foramen magendae. That serves as the outlet for CSF to extend from ventricle to the subarachnoid space. If you have a persistent Blake's pouch cyst, the CSF outflow is obstructed. Therefore, Blake's pouch cyst typically present with some degree of hydrocephalus. And this is an important distinction between this and megacisterna magna. Megacisterna magna should not cause obstruction, therefore no hydrocephalus. The posterior fossa here is not enlarged, unlike Dandy Walker malformation, and the vermis should be normal in size. What about this case? The vermis looks normal. The fourth ventricle is also normal. The TV angle is zero. The posterior fossa is not enlarged. There's no hydrocephalus. This is megacisterna magna. If the inferior aspect of the subarachnoid space is greater than 10 mm on the mid-sagittal view, you have megacisterna magna. It is due to delayed fenestration of Blake's pouch. Unlike Blake's pouch cyst, where the Blake's pouch is not fenestrated, this is due to delayed fenestration leading to enlargement of the subarachnoid space. The key point here is that this is subarachnoid space, so therefore there's no obstruction at the foramen magendae. So patients should not have hydrocephalus. In fact, megacisterna magna is considered as a normal anatomical variant. What about this case right here? The vermis, you can see the third lobe is noticeably smaller than the other two, so you have inferior vermian hypoplasia. The fourth ventricle is enlarged. The tegmental vermian angle is also widened. The posterior fossa, though, is normal, and there's no hydrocephalus. When you have a widened TV angle, you would also expect the fastigian to be abnormally turned upwards. So this is the inferior vermian hypoplasia, used to refer to as Dandy Walker variant. Again, that's a term that we try to discourage nowadays. This diagnosis should not be made before 18th gestational week. Prior to that, the inferior vermis growth over the fourth ventricle is incomplete, so you would have incomplete covering of the fourth ventricle. That's normal finding before 18th week. Here's another example for inferior vermian hypoplasia. You have a T2 weighted image, T1 weighted image, with a corresponding CT, which we have a measurement of 34 degree. Compare that to this entity, where the TV angle is not that abnormally widened. You do have enlargement of the cystic space inferior to the vermis, but the inferior vermis does not appear to be significantly smaller than other two. There is mild mass effect on the inferior vermis, and there's a mild hydrocephalus. So this one right here is Blake's pouch cyst. Lastly, what about this entity? Here we have two different patients with the same diagnosis. The vermis for both patients are normal. There is a mild mass effect against the posterior aspect of the vermis. The fourth ventricle is normal. The tegmental vermian angle is normal. The posterior fossa is not enlarged, except for the small scalloping of the posterior aspect tentorium. There's no hydrocephalus. Because the TV angle is normal, you expect to have a normal configuration of fastigium. You do have a scalloping of the occipital bone, signifying that this is a long-standing process. So this is an arachnoid cyst. So by using those landmarks, you should be able to identify this common posterior fossa cystic malformation. Now back to those four cases. Patient A, we have a classic picture of Dandy Walker malformation. Patient B, inferior vermian hypoplasia. Patient C, hydrocephalus, obstruction, you have a Blake's pouch cyst. Patient D, you have enlargement of subarachnoid space inferior to the vermis without other anomalies. That's megacisterna magna, a normal anatomical variant. I hope that's helpful. Thank you. Have a good day.